So now let's talk about the pipeline control logic. That is, how do we decode and keep track of what instructions are supposed to do in the pipeline? So here's what I showed you before. We have our 5-stage pipeline, and at each stage we store the instruction so the later stages will know what to do. We should ask the question, do we really need the instruction at every pipeline stage? And the answer to this question is no, we only need some bits for each stage. That is, each stage needs specific information about the instruction so it knows what it's supposed to do, but doesn't necessarily need all of the instruction. So this is called instruction decode, and let's take a look at how it works. Here we've got our 5 pipeline stages, and after we've read the instruction, we're going to put it into some control logic. And this control logic is going to figure out bits for what each of the stages do later on. So it figures out bits for the write-back stage, the memory stage, and the execute stage. Now in the execute stage, we use those bits to figure out what to do and control our combinational logic. The other bits for the memory stage just get forwarded to the next pipeline register along with the write-back bits, because we don't need them in the execute stage. Now in the memory stage, we use the bits from the memory control, and we take the write-back bits and we forward them on to the last pipeline stage so that we can use them to control the write-back. So now you can see why the second stage is called decode. It's because we're decoding the instruction into control signals, which we then send through the pipeline. So let's take a look at the pipeline control in detail. So here's a picture from the book which includes the control signals as well as the pipeline registers, and let's walk through it. So in the first pipeline stage, we load the instruction and put it in the pipeline register. Now in the second stage, in decode, we're going to decode that through the control logic into these individual bits for each stage. So the bits for the execute stage go into the pipeline register, and we use them in the execute stage to control what goes on. We have bits which control what the ALU does. Is it doing AND or subtract? We have bits that control the input. Should it be from the register file, or should it be from the sign extended immediate? And we have bits that control which destination register we're going to use. Because remember, immediate format and R format instructions have their destination register in different places. We also create control bits for the write-back stage and the memory stage, and we forward those on to the next pipeline register because we don't use them in the execute stage. Now in the memory stage, we're going to use those control bits. We're going to use some of them to control whether we read from the memory or whether we write to the memory, and others to control whether we take the branch that we computed in the previous stage. The write-back bits are just going to be kept moved on to the next pipeline register so they can be used in the write-back stage. And here we're going to use them to determine if we write back to the register file and what we should write back to the register file. Do we write back the data from the memory or from the ALU? So here's a question. Where does write register come from? How do we decide which register we're supposed to write into in the register file? Well, this comes from data in the last pipeline register, that is the memory write-back register. But we need to be careful here because there are two places where we can specify what register we write back to, depending on whether an instruction is an R-type instruction or an I-type instruction. So if you look at the paths here, we have two of them. Here's where we get the write-back register for instructions that use RD. These are R-type instructions. And here's the path for instructions that use RT. These are I-type instructions. So you can see that in the second pipeline stage, instruction decode, we store both of these in the pipeline register. And then the execute stage, we determine which one we want to use and then pass that along through the rest of the pipeline registers. So let's take a look at the flow of instructions through the pipeline. On one axis here I have time, and on the other axis I'm going to have the program execution. So we've got a bunch of clock cycles, and we're going to look at some instructions. So here's a load word instruction. In the first cycle it's going to access the instruction memory. Then in the second cycle it's going to read from the register file, do an ALU op in clock cycle 3, this is to calculate the address. In clock cycle 4 it's going to access the data memory, and finally in clock cycle 5 it's going to write back the results from the memory. Now if we look at what some other instructions are going to do, they're going to overlap. So at the same time as the first instruction is doing its decode and reading the register file, the second instruction is going to access the instruction memory to do instruction fetch. Similarly, the third instruction is going to overlap, and what we see when we write these all out is our full pipeline. And remember, the benefit of the pipeline is this right here. Now in cycle 4, we have 3 instructions in flight. The first load instruction is accessing the data memory in the mem stage. The second instruction is using the ALU to calculate the address in the execute stage. And the third instruction is accessing the register file in the instruction decode phase. Because we have three instructions using three different parts of the processor at the same time, we get better performance. So here's a question. How many instructions per cycle would we get if we kept doing load instructions forever? Well, we get one instruction per cycle. If the pipeline is full, we'll finish one instruction every cycle or have an IPC of 1.0. So here's a question about the MIPS pipeline. Why do we have an AND gate for the branch logic? Well, the reason we have an AND gate here is this is for branch equal. So if jump is true and the ALU output is 0, then we should take a branch on a branch equal. So this logic gets the branch signal from the control logic, which has been sent through the pipeline, and it gets the 0 signal from the pipeline register. The ALU wrote the 0 signal into the pipeline register on the previous cycle. So if those are both true, then you should branch. Now note this is the wrong logic if you want to do branch not equals. This is just because we had a simplified processor for these examples.